Hey, hey, welcome to my podcast. I'm Manina, and you are listening to an episode of Aspire Big, Inspire Bigger podcast. Welcome back to my channel. Welcome to the Aspire Big, Inspire Bigger podcast. Today, I have a special guest, RJD the Imperfect Gentleman, and he inspires men to find their imperfect gentleman, the inner imperfect gentleman. Thank you for joining me on my podcast today.
Thank you for having me. I'm humbled. I'm grateful to be here. Thank you.
So usually when I start up the podcast, I just ask my guests to just let me know a little bit about them, what led them to their moment. So, can you let us know what led you to your moment?
Well, first off, positive energy and good vibrations from me to you. This is RJD, the Imperfect Gentleman. My epiphany moment for me to start this journey was literally one night me sitting in the bed and just me thinking about all the things I needed as a young man, all the lessons I wish I would have learned up until the age I currently am, and I said to myself, it's crazy that the things that I need is not too far-fetched. Like, it can be something that should be taught, maybe even taught in our school system. So I said, you know what, I couldn't find a program. So I said, you know what, if I can't find one, I want to make one. So that led me to creating The Imperfect Gentleman. The course is actually still in the works, still under construction, as we can say. Almost there.
Oh, good. Where did you grow up? Like, what kind of things did you grow up around, and what taught you to be a young man before you came to that?
Man. Well, the streets. I was born and raised in Queens, New York, and I was raised in Long Island, New York. Shout out to everybody in the hood. You already know. Shout out to the hood. Shout out to Amityville. You know what it is. And honestly, it was just, you know, the typical young black kid. You grow up in the street, face stuck in the street, trying to chase these false realizations of what success looks like or confidence, right? The things we chased around and looked for was things that were literally harmful to us. We thought that the guys driving the big cars and getting all the women was the ones that was living the right life. And in all actuality, that's not the way to go about life. So I found myself chasing my tail, you know what I'm saying? Like a whole bunch of young men do, just running around chasing the streets. And I always equated to those cartoons you see when the little guys are running in the desert and they're so thirsty and they start seeing mirages of water and they run to it and they disappear. That's what it was for me. Cause every time I reached another level in the street that I felt that was success, it would leave me, it would disappear. And I would feel empty. So the moment I would feel like, oh yeah, I got the car that I wanted, or I got the girls that I wanted, I'm still sitting in that car with that woman completely lonely. So I knew it had to be something else in life. So my background is literally just maybe a young man who was basically raised in the church. I got tired of dealing with what's going on in the church house, and I wanted to go experience the world for myself. I went out there and found out that the world, everybody was telling me why the world was right, that I shouldn't have been out there to begin with. But, you know, hard had to make a self behind, so I had to figure out my way.
So funny that you talked about being in the desert and thinking you see that oasis, right? Me and you spoke a couple of days ago, maybe almost a week ago now, and I gave you some background. My father, he's from Africa, but he's from Mauritania, which is next to Morocco, so he's from the desert, right? Mm. And so I got a little story for you. He told me, and it was so funny, he was a little kid, and him and his group of kids, they were always running around and playing. So his mother sent him over to the next village, which would be a lot for us maybe, but it was about 2-3 miles or something like that, you know, but it's desert.
Yeah, it's a journey.
But now, so they got there. Right before they got there, one of the boys ran off and followed some kind of little bird that he saw. So my father and the other kids look at each other like, oh, we can't let him go by himself. So they go after him, running and playing with the bird and trying to catch it. And so time passes, and now everybody's blazing hot. People about to faint. Mm. And my father said he remembered where they came from, you know, before they ran off. But right when he got to where he remembered they were, he thought he saw water. And just at that moment, he was so thirsty, all dehydrated. He said they almost, all of them almost lost their life. The first, the friend who first followed the bird, he literally almost died because he wanted to play. When you said that, it just made me think of that story. It connected to me for how you said the young men, young women. I'm from Harlem. I'm from, you know, from New York City. And it's the same thing. Young ladies, if y'all are chasing y'all tail or chasing a tail, right? The young lady is running from somebody chasing the tail, but we're still going in a circle, right?
We
still
absolutely. We it's what my grandmother's called, the blind leading the blind.
Oh yes. Oh yes. So it just made me think of that story that my dad told me, because it really is like you think you're getting somewhere, like, all right, I let me do this. I could finagle this, and you not getting nowhere, but you're killing yourself, you're playing yourself, nowhere. You know. Nowhere. So that made me think of that. That made me think of that.
Nah, like it's really dope to understand, to really know that before what you thought was real, and when you have the realizing that it's not, and then to find out what real life is about, that's where the beauty is. Like, now that I see what I thought was real to compare what is real right now for me, is like, wow, okay. I wasted a lot of time, but at the same time, that time was wasted. It was growth time, right? It wasn't really wasted. It was time growing.
Right. It's really, that's what it is. That's really what it is. So, imperfect gentleman. Mm-hmm. What's an imperfect gentleman?
Oh, okay. Well, the word imperfect, right? It actually reads, I'm perfect. I got that word from a good man upstairs. One night I was in the bed, and my wife was like, what's wrong with you? I couldn't sleep. I was restless. And I was like, yo, babe, I feel like I'm led to create this online image or this person, but I don't know what to call myself. I'm not perfect. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to call myself. And literally I went to sleep on that thought. And I woke up the next morning, the first thing that came to my mind, normally when I wake up in the morning, my first word is thank you God for waking up. But the first thing in my mind was imperfect. Mm-hmm. You are imperfect. Go with that. So I'm like, So I said to myself, nah, that's kind of corny, right? Then my homeboy actually broke the word down for me, right? He actually showed me how cool the word was, because he said, if you look at it and you break the word down, it reads, I'm perfect. And in no actuality, in our imperfection is when God is made perfect. So as long as we stay imperfect and working to our perfection, we already manifest into perfection, because God sees us as how we're supposed to be and not how we are. Right. So with that being said, that I now know that I'm imperfect, and I'm perfectly fine with being imperfect, because I know that that's where my strength lies. And I truly now understand the meaning of imperfect, and I want to spread that word to every young man around the world, because too many times we're walking around here trying to perfect something that cannot be perfected. This human flesh, this human body cannot be perfected. It is not perfection. But right. The one thing, once you know that and dwell in it and realize it, that's when you realize, wow, your imperfections make you perfect. So that's where the name came from. And also, I've always been a gentleman. My mother made it her business. I was raised by a single mother up until I was the age of, I think it was 12, or she'd been my stepfather. And her two biggest things to me was, number one, you're going to be respectful. And number two, you will be a gentleman. Those two things, if anybody says anything else other than those two things, you got a problem with me. And I don't know if anybody know my mama. I don't want that smoke.
Right. Nobody don't ever want no problem with their mama. Nah, not a mama.
Not with old girl. Not with no black right. mama. You hear me?
Right. Hello. No, I know. For the young women, I know you helped the young men, but you had to be familiar with the young woman's plight in order to make these men suitable for the world.
Yes. Oh yes.
That the
it's
young
so women. It's so funny and it's so dope that you actually said that, because that's what I study the most. Like, people always say, like, you must study a lot of men. I do, to understand and to show them themselves, but. And in order for me to help them and to walk them into the space of interacting correctly with the female, I have to study them. I have to go back into the books. I have to have conversations with women as yourself. So I spend a lot of my time, majority of my time in my research in with women. So, and before I even get into deep into research, what I want to say is to the women is this. Whatever you say and you create in this world, we have to follow as men. So I want y'all to understand and take back your power. This is what I've been preaching for the last year. I want the women to take back and own their power. Because the truth of the matter is there are a lot of reasons why us men are walking around here not really upholding our weight or being who we are supposed to. It's because of y'all allowing it.
Listen, you saying that to the you preaching to the choir right here. I know a lot of women, it's so crazy to me. You know, us women, we can have the best of friends and we could be really honestly going through totally different mindsets about womanhood, about relationships. We could really be thinking different. But I am a total believer that the woman holds the standard. I'm big on, you know, I have a shirt written on my chest, woman of noble character. Now, if you're holding character or integrity, that means just that. You're not switching. You're not going back and forth. You're not letting yourself be swayed here and there. Mm-hmm. And no matter how many times or how much somebody pursues you to do something that is not in you, you don't fall for that. So women hold the standard. We don't have to run the man. That's not what we're here to do, but we hold the standard. We control where we are and who we are. If you don't accept what you don't deserve, you don't receive it.
Plain and simple. Talk about it. And this is why I guess my friends call me so blunt with it, because it's like, I tell the girls the truth. If you're talking about he ain't doing nothing, just giving him some. If he ain't got a job, why he laid up in your bed?
Right.
If he's not providing, why are you providing for him? We always say about it's a two-way street, so then drive your car like it's a two-way street, mommy. Right? Because the same way you say, oh, he's not doing something, well, you can make him do something. And if you can't make him do something by your behaviors, then it's okay to step. See, I don't understand why we've gotten to this point where we cannot be alone. And women, and what I'm saying is, I'm not saying that God says, the Bible says that no man should be alone. Don't get that wrong. But what I'm saying is, you don't have to be with somebody else to bring you down just because you don't want to be alone. I speak to a lot of females, especially at my job, because I work with 90% with females. And I spend most of my time there counseling for some reason. And all the time I tell them is like, yo, I hear their stories out, and I hear them all the way out, sometimes almost hours. I listen to them completely out, and I then stay at the end of it all. But you have the power to stop it. The power is yours, because the truth of the matter is the person that you allow to do something to you only does it because you allow it. Nobody can do anything to you that you don't allow or something that you don't appreciate that you don't allow. So my message to women is, if you being alone keeps your sanity, then enjoy being alone until the right one comes about.
That's it. And you're not strange, and you're not bitter. You're not any of those things for being on your own. It's not, like I said, as a woman, I have heard a lot, because like you said, when I realized what I deserve and realized what I bring and what I can and cannot accept, some women could deal with some things and some women are at different places. But yep. There's certain things that are just not going to work for me. I want to be as ladylike, as loving and gentle as possible. But the thing is, I was raised by my dad. And he don't play that, so I don't play that either. I don't have a problem with telling you, let me explain to you how you're not going to talk to me. Or let me explain to you what I'm not going to accept here. You don't like it? That's fine. Yeah. I got big cousins. You're not scared of me? I got big cousins. They'll be here. We're on the top of you to go.
That's it. That's a fact.
But, you know, that's all joke aside, you know, it really is up to you. But you do have friends as women. You will have friends who tell you, you're just too picky. You're never going to find anybody who's perfect. So you just need to stop being so picky. You'll have that as women. So yes, like you said, women need to hold the standard to themselves and to each other. And if we did that as a unit, there'll be a lot less of the heartbreak for the ladies who decided to settle. If y'all would have held the standard, you know, y'all wouldn't be so heartbroken either. He wouldn't be able to cheat on you, because every woman would be holding the standard.
Come on now. Come on. Like, we as men, I mean, I know the dog pound and the men that probably hear this is probably like, yo, you messing up. I don't care. I don't care, fellas. it's time for us to really start owning up, because the truth of the matter is a lot of us men believe, and it's deep within us that we believe that once we do meet a girl, that she's below us or she's not there to help us. And there's a constant battle between the two. In no actuality, if you're not ready or mentally ready for a female, you shouldn't be searching for one. And that's where I got to come at these fellas at. A lot of us is out here talking about, oh, yeah, she don't want to submit to the king. First of all, do you know what it takes to be a king? Whoa. Number one. And yes, the Bible does say submit to a wife, submit to your husband. But guess what? In order for her to submit, you got to be a husband first. Do you know what a husband entails? Do you know what a husband even means? Until you find out, until you actually live, until you become one of those, you can't ask for somebody to call you a their king. You can't ask for a woman to follow you, because in no actuality, that's what we're asking for. We, as men, we're asking you to come behind us, follow us to this vision that we see in our mind, and y'all supposed to be okay with it. But majority of us men are walking around visionless, and we want somebody to follow them.
That's it.
I know I'm going to lose some male followers, but I'm all right with that.
That's all right. And if they come over here, they ain't going to get no less with spanking. I'm all right with that, too.
Indeed.
I ain't scared of y'all. So, but yes, it's the truth. It's really about the vision. And it's really awesome, even how we met on the morning calls, the entrepreneurship call. And yes, the people on there, no matter where we are in our quest, we have vision. We're looking for the best out of life, and we're looking to organize something, figure something out to make what we have better. Help us to become whole as a person. I'm sure that's what 99.99% of people on that call are trying to do. But like you said, if you, as a man, if you don't have vision and direction, you might find a girl who'll give you the time of day for a little bit, but then y'all even could get to marriage, all of those things. Y'all even could get to having children. But then there's going to be the day when she realizes he is not taking me anywhere.
Yes. Yes.
It's usually when the kids come. When that kid come, usually us women, we like, so what's your plan? Because it was but cute, see, but...
Let's address that, because this is a part of my book that I'm writing. It's called Real Men Don't Run, But Some Need to Retreat. This is a part of the book that I'm writing, because it's like a lot of us get into this space of being somebody's boyfriend, right? Then time lapses, and that boyfriend turns to a fiance, and we don't even know it. Like, as men, we don't even know. We go from boyfriend to fiance. It's like, oh, shoot, when did that happen? And then you blink a few more times, and you look up in your husband, and now you're a father. But in that space of time, when you wasn't understanding that time was moving, guess what happened? You got older. This woman's getting older along with you. You now have created a life. And now guess what? Everything that you were supposed to have done before you got into a relationship with this woman is now coming to your front of your face now. And now you're frustrated. Now you lash out because you're angry. Now you get physically aggressive because you don't have no answers. This is what all happens because you didn't do the work in the beginning. Now, for instance, a young lady last week just spoke to me about this, and she asked me this question that I was so glad she asked me. She said, yo, Rob, I've been out here, I'm looking for this dude, but I know you told me I should work on myself, but what should I be doing in the time being? Now, listen to me, ladies and gentlemen, listen to me and listen to me good. When you out here and you are single, you should not be looking for another individual. What you should be doing is preparing yourself for the right individual, getting yourself prepared. Mentally, right? My young queen right here said she wakes up at 4:30 in the morning now, meditates to work out. And guess what? Then she has a business, school, and a job. So now, with all that being said, a young king has to now come about prepared, not to invade her time, to not to move her life around, but to come add value to her life, correct? So now,
right.
Once you've added the value, she has no problem with saying, you know what, yeah, I'm going to make some time for you today. I'm going to make some time for you today. And then guess what? You provided value to her, and she's now also providing value to you. And that's called the relationship. We get into these things that I call situationship, where you're only getting 50% of one person. The other person only give you 5%. And it's nothing but arguments going down because nobody's giving them their full self.
I remember when you were in pre-K and you got the dolls and the toys and the things like that, and you play as if you're that. So you got the little doctor station. You play like you're a doctor. If a real patient came in there, they gonna die on your table. This is not real. This is just for play. It's the same thing when the real world comes into your lap, when you're unprepared and you're not intentional about your life. That's the important thing. That's the point. The point is, it's not about finding someone. When does that start? When you start looking, it's about being intentional with the things you do in your life. Intentional with your thoughts. Intentional with your desires. Let your desires be something of nobility first before something that has to do with another person.
Yes.
You know, desire to be great first.
Yes.
At least if you feel great and you are doing things that great people do or work towards that, and even if you're not attracting them yet, you're going to know how to get those ones that are not great up out of your way. Because a lot of young people don't know what to do. Yeah? Did I take it?
It's my favorite slogan. Everybody, every time I leave any kind of live, any kind of leave kind of show, I say the same exact thing. It's be good to yourself and the ones around you. And if you cannot be good to the ones around you, get those folk from around you.
Oh.
That's it.
So it's important that we look at the youth. Like you said, like what you're doing with the young men is important. What I want to do with the young women is very important because it's really the base story, the base lesson of it all is intention. If we just had intention when we were younger, I'm sure you and I both would be billionaires by now.
Cool.
Multi. Okay.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
We were trying to figure out something else that was not necessary. It just was not necessary. It was just not necessary. It meant nothing to life. That's okay.
Nothing.
You know, you live and you learn, but the youth, they deserve that, you know, that hint. At least give them a hint. Hey, it's about being intentional.
Yes, that's it.
You know, because you gotta remember our age and your knees hurt. It's hard to start working out then, because my knees hurt working out now. It's hard to start working out then. But when you were 15 and you worked out until you were 35, it's a different feeling. It's like second nature.
You got to remember, these kids got to remember too, it's like, we got to remember that when we was that age, we didn't want to hear it, right? So like you said, just to mention, because that's what I do now. I'll literally go see a group of young men and walk past them and be like, yo, fellas, life is precious. See y'all later, man. Simply. Like, because remember, at that age, you didn't want to hear no old head walk up on you preaching no gospel to you. You didn't want to hear none of that. You was too busy doing what you was doing. But there was somebody that came past every so often, or you seen something, or you heard something that somebody just simply said to you really quick and it stuck to you. So I always try to use the throwing crap against the wall theory. Every time I see your kid somewhere, your young man somewhere, I throw a positive word out there, hope it stick. You know what I'm saying? Because at the end of the day, we're out here to give them the chance, the fighting chance. Because that's what, no actuality, we really wish we had it growing up anyway, is a fighting chance, somebody to show us something anyway.
Mm-hmm. And the important thing is for us to succeed and be intentional still in what we're doing. Because when kids see successful people, that's the other thing. Sometimes our parents be trying to tell us stuff, but then you watch your mom and your dad sit there and smoke cigarettes. Or eat until obesity, and then they trying to tell you you're supposed to be the best you that you are. Like,
yeah,
all right, mom, but ask me a rib. You know, success changes that too. We have to be that successful person that they come to and be like, so let me ask you a question. How do I do such and such because I want this? You know, that's important too.
So that's another reason why I speak to young men and I tell them, I don't care if you go into the corner store. Put your best outfits on. It's about the mindset. So if you just going out to the store and you put nothing on, you don't care how you look. You're not putting your best foot forward. Now, how do you know that your queen is not going to be at that store, right? Yeah. See, it's about being prepared. Like you say, like for instance, when they came down to meet me and my wife, I didn't know she could be my wife. But at the same time, before I met her, I was preparing myself for her. What was I doing? I was working. I was building my credit, trying to get myself into a home. See, all these things I was doing before I went out to go find her. Right? Like, it's so many things that men and women should be doing before we get into relationships with other people, because the best relationship we should have is with ourselves.
Right.
The best relationship you could possibly have with anyone is yourself.
That's
right. And when you master that relationship, that's when you're able to go out and truly love someone else and give someone your whole you.
And get the most out of life. Because it is a give and take. It's when you're best able to get the most out of life. Even if we took it away from the relationship, it's like I mentioned earlier, this call. If your mind frame is an entrepreneur, then the morning call is not going to do anything for you. But an entrepreneur could have been running in circles. I'll take myself as an example. This is something I tried to start since 2014, running in circles, not knowing that I had access to something like that, to a whole group of people who are looking to do the same thing and doing something further, or, you know, whatever, wherever they are in the journey. And in the past 2 weeks, I've done more than I have been able to do since 2014 until now. So when you have your mind set and you know what you want out of life or out of a situation, that's when you can go out and connect with the people who are like-minded. That's where that comes from. And you will get the most out of that situation. But if you just go in there like, I don't know what I want to do. I think I just want to be rich. I made a t-shirt, so I want people to buy it. And that's it. Like, that's cute. And then David's like, that's all nice. Right. Me too.
Let's think about this.
Right. Yeah, that's his thing. Right.
David says, man, in the whole morning meetup crew, shout out to the squad, man.
Yes, man. That is life changing. So, yeah, be intentional. That's important. Yes. Be intentional, which will lead you to be ready. Prepare yourself. And what's one more tip that you could give to a young lady or young woman who is looking for the best out of life?
I always look at it this way when I speak, especially speak to young ladies. I think of my daughter. She's 4 years old. And I know that these are a lot of things I say to women now, I'm going to have to repeat at some point to her. So I was going to give this.
Four is not too young. No, for real.
Yes. No, oh, no, she gets it right now. Our biggest argument last week was about her sitting correctly with a dress on. She's like, but what? Like, no, ladies sit with their legs closed, sweetheart. You have a dress on. But dad, I didn't know it. No bad dad, nothing. This is what you're supposed to do, and you have to do it.
Right.
But, My message to the young ladies are, be true to your teaching. Be true to the lessons that you learned all throughout life. Don't get older and forget your heritage. Don't get older and forget the lessons that your parents went so hard to show you, because in those lessons is where your greatest gifts are. Mm-hmm. Even for myself personally, when it comes down to my grandmother, she sat me down so many days and just beat me with certain jewels into my head, to where now I find myself actually living those jewels or handing those jewels to other women. Because remember, every decision you make, everything that you learn, you are an equate sum up until right now of your life. So everything that brought you up to this point here is usable. So don't forget it, right? Your mother taught you some things. Your father taught you some things. If you was privileged to have brothers and sisters, they've showed you some things. Life has showed you a lot. So only thing I'm going to say is, don't forget your lessons and take those lessons and implement them. And don't let nobody else sidetrack you from doing what you want to do. And us fellas are slick talkers, ladies. Listen, what I'm telling you. You are listening to one of the slickest talkers you will ever see. I am a chameleon at one point in my life. I made it my business to find a way to turn into whatever one woman wanted, just so I can get what I wanted. So understand that everything that glitters is not gold. Every young man that opens his mouth is not a prayer book coming out of it.
Correct. I second that. That's all I have to say about that check. Honey.
I'm just giving it as real as I possibly can, man. Because at the end of the day, like Lauren said, men only want one thing. Right? Mm-hmm. Like I can't sit here and sugarcoat it because nobody did it for me. Every man in the world wants one thing, sweetheart. And the truth of the matter is, if you give the wrong man your gold, you'll be sitting there with an empty pot.
And they're going to squander it anyway. They're going to get it and squander it. They're not going to do nothing with that gold either.
They're going to wear it out. They're going to wear it out and then go look for somebody, another victim. That's it. Gold. And then they end up living their lives literally out here looking crazy. I got homeboys right now that literally I'm talking about every day together from junior high school up until manhood, right? And now in life, Now, I'm not judgmental about any of the situations, but in life in general, you can just tell that, are you still doing that? This is what you're currently doing still at 36? Well, we was doing it at 15 and 19. Wait a minute.
Yes, they are. There's many of them out there doing it still.
I got a phone call from a gentleman. Yo, I'm about to go out here. I'm about to run down these shorties. Yo, run down. You're almost 40, bro.
First of all, shorty.
You're not running. Like, you can barely walk. Like, what are you talking about, man?
What you're not doing is running, right?
You're doing a whole lot of not running.
That's right. What you're doing. You're not even walking fast, bro.
Not even a little bit. I'm telling you. And then for what? For you to go and this is what makes me so mad. Ladies, stop letting these men trick you into ruining your life. Like, just because he looked good, just because he smelled good, man, you might have made a mistake and gave him some. Just because he feel good. Listen, after that feeling is over, that's it. When that tingle in your pants is over with, that is it. Real life is still here. When your tomorrow, if God spares you, it's still going to be there. Mm-hmm. And don't let him or somebody else ruin that for you, because you're going to be the only one crying on the phone with your homegirls. And guess what? He's going to be out there doing what he's doing.
Yeah, we tired of hearing it. Tell me them about this, man. Well, I told you about 51 times, you just looking at me like I'm too picky, and you've been single for long, so it must not be working. No, clearly it's working. I ain't called you crying about nobody in years.
Come on. Another thing, I'm glad you said that too. Let's stop going to each other for advice when we're not successful, right? Like, I'm not gonna go to my homeboy who has not had a relationship more than 3 months and ask him what to do with my marriage. It's not gonna happen. Right. A lot of us is going around talking to our friends because they're our friends, looking for advice in relationships, and our friends are in a worse situation than we are. Mm-hmm. A lot of times the girls you're talking to literally are trying to figure out life just as well, as hard as you are, if not worse. Instead of talking to your homegirls, go talk to an older lady. For crying out loud, if you want to learn about a man, go talk to an older man. Go sit down with one. It ain't always going to be about sex. Have a conversation. Learn something for a change. And I promise you, it'll change.
You learn something about yourself, for sure. Sitting down with your elders, you will learn something about yourself. And there's a lot of women who don't have sense. So when you're talking to a woman who has sense, she sounds like she has all the answers. But yeah, it's the elders who, some of them, but a no. lot of them do have. Yeah, a lot of, you see somebody with a success rate, you go talk to them. It's true.
Absolutely. That's what you need to Absolutely.
Do. You talk to your elder. You talk to people. I talk to my father. My father, like, he's very traditional, very.
To the book.
Yeah. It's not like, let's have a conversation about, well, Dad, I just. What about boyfriend? He's like, boyfriend? That's American stuff. I don't even know what you're talking to me about. That. That's dumb. You get married. Like, okay. No problem.
Yo, listen, problem. And the crazy part is, like, I appreciate that because it knocks out a lot of the foolishness. Like, it knocks out the emotional BS of what relationships really are, what they could be, to be honest with you.
Yeah. Yeah. And it just makes me... I'm grateful because I am able to say I can't afford to play myself and think I'm just going to bring any kind of person around him, because that's my dad. That's my person. And, you know, he's my family. That's plain and simple. When nobody was there, when I lost my mother, we both lost my mother when I was 12, it was us, you know, and he made sure he did what he had to do. He took care of me. He didn't send me nowhere. You know, you're a young little girl. You got a little girl and you're a young man on your own. My father was at that point 42, you know. Yeah. So at 12, things start changing for little girls at 12.
I want to take this moment to give your dad the ultimate shout out right now, because because there's so many dudes who would have been like, yo, I got a sister, you take care of my daughter for me, like, I gotta get about it, I need somebody to watch her. But he put that time in and put that work in. And let me tell you, as a man who is very, I'm talking about, I'm overly committed in my kids' life. Like, I have no life other than my kids. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to my daughters, like, I see now she's 4 and I already see her emotion, her mood swings happening already. I'm like, man, I don't know what to do. That's and tough. For me to think to myself, wow, yeah, your dad walked through that at 12 to where the hormones boys, life is all coming through at a rapid rate, and he still stayed and implemented being a father in that. Shout out to your pops, man. He's a real imperfect gentleman. Facts.
Yes, he tried. He tried. He did his best. He did more than his best, I believe. I think he did something that he didn't think he was capable of doing, for sure.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. No question. No man thinks he can raise a daughter. No man. Yeah.
Because my grandmother, his mother, was definitely like, send her with us. You don't know what you're doing with her. And he was like, Mama, you live in Africa. She was like, yeah. What? So, yeah. Yeah, for sure. But that's important. It's important to stick to what you know. That all of that being said is, like what you said, stick to your lessons. Stick to what you know. Stick to what you've been taught. And if you don't think you've been taught enough, ask somebody who succeeded in the area, for sure. For sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So in my podcast, we're dwindling to the end. So in my podcast, I have a thing called Introvert Corner. I'm a stark introvert, which to me means if I don't see nobody, I'm all right with that. If I can stay in the house and do all the things I need to do, and that was the world, I'm fine. Quarantine has not affected me negatively at all, except for the quarantine. If people got the quarantine 15, I got the like quarantine 8 or 10, but that's just because I guess I was being lazy, because I have a whole treadmill in my house and everything, so that has nothing to do with being outside either. But me knowing other introverts, we're not just gonna come out and be like, hey, I don't really talk to strangers, but can you tell me something new about life that I maybe don't know? I'm definitely not speaking to another introvert right here, right?
Definitely not. Okay. By no means. Okay, I think I'm overly extroverted at some points.
Okay, good, good. Because I feel like you can teach us some things. So what I do is I ask three introspective questions, or try to. I hope they're introspective. And you answer them the way that your brain would answer it, and you might give us introverts something to think about in a different way to phrase life, or, you know, different situations that we might not put ourselves in. All right?
Cool. I'm with it. Let's go. Shoot.
All right. And they're all random, so I don't know what they're going to be. All right. So the first one is, what are you amazingly good at?
I'm amazingly good at playing the drums, actually. I'm a really good drummer. People who don't know me from a child would think that's really, really, really random, but I'm really good at playing the drums. Ooh. I'm really good at listening. Like, I do really well at listening to people. I actually just took a course like 2 years ago on being an active listener. So I pride myself now on being a pretty dope listener.
See, you helped the introvert. Look at that. You already helped me. All right. So the second question. Cool. What do most people overestimate or underestimate about you?
People underestimate my passion for life, my passion for others. People underestimate how hard I will go for my brother. If I'm committed to you, there's no time of day, there's no hour of day that I won't give myself if I've committed myself to you. I think sometimes in my earliest stages, even to a fault, you know, jump out the window for people you shouldn't be doing. Now, overestimate is my niceness. Like, I must say, like, especially in my job, people overestimate how nice I am. Like, see, I've become this nice. I've worked to be this nice as a gentleman. I've become this gentleman. I wasn't always a gentleman now. In order to be something, you have to come from something. In order to transform, you have to once be something different. And the other person that I once was before this was a nice individual. Wasn't a gentleman by no sorts. So I really, truly believe that people that see me now overestimate how nice I am. Because at the end of the day, I'm still an animal on the inside.
Right, of course, of course. We all have our traits and our old habits that we had to overcome, but we can find them. They're not too far.
Yes. Oh, no. My grandfather used to say, I ain't fought in a long time, but I ain't forgot either. You know what I'm saying? My grandfather used to tell me all the time, boy, I ain't fought nobody, but I ain't forgot now.
For real? That's how it goes, That's so funny. Real quick, my father always said, I just can't wait. Like, can't wait for what, Dad? He said, I can't wait till they start giving out the jobs where we see the young kids, the older elders, we can take our stick and see the young kids, whop, whop, pick up the pants. pop.
Yes.
Be quiet.
Yes.
I said, they're not doing that. That's abuse. That he said, oh, no, 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 no. They're going to make it a job. I promise you. They're going to make it a job. I'm going to be the first one in the line. So, yes.
Yo, and I might be with him on the old head, man. Pick your pants up. Yo, yeah. The crazy part is a lot of these kids don't even know where that originated from.
Which is
and if they really knew. If they knew where it originated from, I could guarantee you 98.9 of these kids will not have their pants lower. Mm-hmm. Now, I said 98.9 because they're going to get a percentage of them that don't care.
Right.
Whatever the reason right. that may be.
Because
but
it's intentional.
If they were educated.
That's their business.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Exactly. I say like it's so many of us not knowing what we're doing out here. We're doing it unconsciously and not knowing the history of it, which is so dangerous.
It's true. All right. Third question, last question.
All right.
You ready?
Here we go.
What was an obstacle you faced and how did you handle it?
Well, that's crazy. The first thing that came to my mind when you said that just now was a very, very personal moment I guess I'm going to get deep on. I've been my wife for now 15 years and we've been married now for about five. We just celebrated our five-year anniversary. Prior to this, almost five years ago, right before we got married, I cheated on my wife. It was the hardest thing in my life I had to deal with because not only did I cheat on her, I got caught doing it. I would have said that the most easy thing to do would have been just walking away from the situation, just leaving it alone and just divorcing and separating ways. But the hardest thing to do was to face up to my wife, admit what I did, and try to work through it. That was the hardest thing I've ever done in my entire life because every day for that month period, I had to look into my wife's eyes and see the pain that I caused. Every single day, I had to hear the struggle in her voice of her even wanting to converse with me because of the pain that she felt. And me as her husband, it broke me on the inside because I said to myself, I vowed to love and protect and care for you. And here I am, the one that vowed to do that in front of God and everybody else in that same church is the one who's crushing you and hurting you right now. So the hardest thing for me to do was to man up and become a man and say, you know what, I made a mistake. I messed up. I effed up. I did that. But what I'm not going to do is ever do it again and learn from my mistakes and live through them. So therefore, somebody else can understand that you don't have to go that route. Because in no actuality, I had not quite understood and realized the total task of being a husband. And this is why I preach so hard to young men. Please understand what you're getting involved with before you do, because in the long run, you end up hurting or crushing or killing someone else for you not understanding about the title or the job that you're going to get yourself into. Right. So that was the hardest thing I had ever do in my life was to confront my wife and get through that part of my infidelity.
I'm glad you did. I'm sure your family that you have created with her is going to be filled with great. Your children are going to be great because you took that courage to stand up and say to yourself, grow up, dude, you know.
Yeah.
and that is what a true leader has to do. And your children, your son and your daughter, your wife, they're going to really prosper because of that choice, for sure. Coming from another woman who we see the difference, you know, we see the difference as women when a man decides versus when he just, so, and we see the different families of men who decided to do it the right way. They're like light years ahead. It's so good. It's so good. So thanks for sharing that. Cause
and it's so important without understanding that right now, I think back to saying I would have gave up, my son, my daughter would have literally be out here with so many questions. So many unanswered questions and so lost in a space where all I had to do was man up and just stop thinking life is all about me. Because that's a lot of times what we all think about is all about me. We got to get out of our own selves and think about somebody else first because in no actuality, that's what makes the world go round.
That's right. I want to also say when it comes to that for young women, if you are experiencing or if you have experienced that, we can't even say young men, women. So women in general, if you experience that with a guy or with your husband, you know, it does take a lot. And I feel like maybe men don't understand that until It happens. I don't understand the depth of how much it takes as a woman to rectify, have to now rectify a pain that you did not create. There's so many traumas that we go through from childhood, and people don't even mean to do that to us. And we are going through it, and we're living with it day in and day out. And the moment that somebody who you, you know, came together with does that, it literally, like, it's like, you know, somebody stomps on your foot by mistake, but your whole foot is sore and it gets swollen. That's all your traumas, right? All your toes is the traumas, your childhood traumas, and in the foot itself is something that you didn't even realize you had in there in your body, and now it's all throbbing, everything all at once. And then on top of that, you got to look at him and say, all right, I'm going to work it out. Even though you didn't bring that to yourself, you know what I'm saying? But it takes a lot of courage to do that as women. But men have to understand that we're not obligated to do it. It's really, if a woman forgives you, it's really because
if
she wants to. If she forgives, she's not obligated, because it's unfair. Definitely. And that's for women to do, you know, women who are doing it to men too, because that happens for sure.
Absolutely.
People are not obligated to let you, to have to be with you or joined with you and forgive you at the same time. They're not. So it's good.
Very true.
It's awesome. It's awesome. You gotta man up. You gotta face up. Woman up. Do the best that you can with every moment that you have. Be intentional. That's the biggest message that I get from our talk today. Be intentional about your life. Intentional about everything that you want out of life, and follow it. Don't let anybody take you from where you want to be, because you will profit. You will grow. You will be all the things that you dreamed of if you stick to the course.
Everybody has a course. Stick to it, y'all. Stick to your aims.
I'm going to make sure that I put all your information down in the info box everywhere where I have my podcast. I have it on like iTunes, Google Podcast, you know, different things like that. So I'll make sure I put all your information there. And if there's anything that you want to leave us with, here's your time.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, this has been a privilege, an honor to be here. I'm grateful to be on your platform. And to all the young women out there, please, please, please be true to yourself. Don't let nobody change your thoughts about who you are. You're valuable. You have value. There's nothing on this earth that can happen to you that can take that value from you. And for all my believers out there, I want to leave this with y'all. You don't got to worry about succeeding, because the good book says that God cannot fail. So if you believe in God and you believe you're his child, you can't fail, because if you fail, he's failed. And that's impossible. So, like I said earlier, be good to yourself and the ones around you. And if you cannot be good to the ones around you, get them folk from around you. This has been RJD, the Imperfect Gentleman. Be blessed, y'all.
Yes, yes. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And I'm going to be on your podcast coming up soon. Like I said, I'll pull your info below.
Yes, indeed.
People can come watch us hang out and get something good from there. All right? Y'all remember to aspire big so that you can inspire bigger. And this is it, y'all. See y'all in the next one.
Peace, y'all.